Absolutely. Listen to me. It ain't nothing but a hot breeze.
Morning, guys. Dragon Man here. I'm in the Colorado Springs Military Museum, and I have 6 machine gun bunkers in this building. I just want to show you my D-Day bunkers. One day after D-Day, it would be June 7th, 1944, and this is an idea what the bunkers and the campsites would have looked like. Okay? So over here, this is just the way the soldiers would have came off the landing craft. See, that's a gas patch. That would turn blue if there was agents in the air and they know to put their M5 gas mask on. These were the weapons that they used back then. They came off the landing craft with a M1 carbine, which to me, that was really a joke. They really didn't stand a chance. An M1 carbine, 30 caliber with a 10-round magazine. Meanwhile, you got the Germans shooting at them with the MG-42s, MG-34s. The other most popular rifle was the M1 Grant. See that? With the bayonet on it. And this shoot 30-06 caliber with a 8-round clip. Not a magazine. It's called a clip because the clip would pop right in there. Okay, let's just move down the aisle here. Give you an idea. I'm just going to point out some of the important stuff here. This is the way the hand grenades were shipped overseas. Here, look at the date. January 1943. See that? We got the hand grenades still in there. Look at that. Pineapple grenade. That's what they used back then. Okay, these are rifle flares. These actually go on the M1 Grant with an adapter, and you pull the cork out. This would go on top of the adapter. It would ignite the rocket with a blank, and it would go up about 300 yards, about 900 feet. A parachute would come out, and it would turn yellow, and that would signal the ships to bring more landing craft to the beach. Here, check it out. This one was made December 1944. See, all dated. Okay, you move down a little bit. This is some of the cooking equipment they'd use. Here's my live 81mm mortar. That's what they would have used on the beach over there. They used the 81mm mortar in World War II, Korea, and right through Vietnam. And here, this is the paperwork that you get when you register a destructed device. Here, see right there? Destructed device, 81mm. And it's very hard to get a permit for a destructive device. You need a very, very good reason for the sheriff to sign the paperwork. And if he does sign the bottom of the paperwork, then it has to go to West Virginia to get approved. That takes about 9 to 10 months. So that's a live 81mm mortar. Anything bigger than a 50 caliber diameter, like a 20mm and up, is registered as a destructive device. Okay, you move down a little bit. This is the Army searchlight that they used on the beach with the original generator, and it still works to signal the ships. And this wooden box here is the way they ship the military dynamite. Here, look at this. Military dynamite, and let's see, dated 1942. I hope you guys could see that. Military dynamite. Okay, and over here is the plastic explosives, C4. Dynamite. See that? And this is the way it would have been shipped overseas. Okay, you move down a little bit. This is the M2 50 caliber machine gun. I now have 16 of them. They fire a 50 caliber bullet. It actually goes about 2,400 feet per second. A 50 caliber bullet is a 660 grain bullet. It's accurate about a mile and a half, and it actually travels almost 5 miles. Okay, you move down a little bit. This is a small medic display. This is a World War II embalming kit for the medics. That's embalming fluid in those little jars. Never used. Okay, let's move down a little more. This here's the switchboard. The switchboard would have been hooked up to all the machine gun bunkers around the area. Everything had to be wired up back then, and it was run with a 6-volt generator. This is the little 6-volt generator, World War II, where the soldier would grab two arms and go like this, about this RPM, and that would put out enough juice to run all the radios. They could actually hook one of the 6-volt generators on here, gasoline generator, but that makes a lot of noise and the enemy would know where they are. Okay, let's switch to this side over here. This is a World War II porta potty. Portable porta potty. Gotta have a porta potty. And this is the type of soap they used back then. This one's still wrapped up in the original paper. The soap is actually made out of horse fat. And not only do I have the original soap, but here, made for the U.S. Army toilet paper. Here, zoom in on that. I go down to the very last detail. Okay, while they're on the porta potty, they can have a Camel cigarette. These are original issued World War II cigarettes. These cigarettes are in this package for over 75 years. I get all this stuff from collectors from all around the world. That there's a Browning 1919-30-06 machine gun. The popular machine guns the Americans used was the Browning 1919-30-06 and the M2 Browning 50 caliber machine gun. Okay, if you move down a little bit, this is what all the cooking equipment looked like. What a collection. You don't get any more realistic than this. Okay, zoom in on those pots. Look at that, 1943. Look at the dates on there. See that? That's why World War I and World War II stuff is so collectible. All the countries dated 98% of everything during World War I and World War II. Okay, let's move down a little bit. Over here's my 60mm mortar. See, and this is the original wooden box that the mortar was shipped overseas in. See that? 60mm mortar, which they use right through Korea and Vietnam. Yeah, see these? 60mm mortar, very popular back then. Okay, these are the 1943 steel casing 45 bullets. They're actually dated 1943, if you can see the back of that. 1943. Everything is as realistic as I can make it. Nobody can make any display more realistic than I just did. Okay, these are the clips. Not a magazine, it's called a clip that holds the 30-06 bullets for the M1 Grant. See that? And we got a whole box of pineapple grenades over there. Okay, we got 50 caliber over here, the M2, with extra barrels. We got the soldier in the back there, he's got an M1 carbine. This is the potbelly stove they would have used to heat up their dinners, their lunch, their suppers, their coffee. Stuff like that. You move down a little bit here. Okay, these are the type of walkie-talkies that they used. See? Hey, Commander, Dragon Man here. We need more men on the beach. Send them in hot. Over. Thank you. These are the walkie-talkies that they communicated with. I have about 24 of them now. Okay, right here, this is a landmine detector. They made 7 different types. I have in my landmine detector display, which we'll make another video maybe next week about it. I have every American landmine detector, and I'm going to show you how landmines work. Okay, look at the little pump tents they have over here. Each soldier would have half a tent in his backpack. So it would take 2 pieces of the tent to put it together. Okay, we're going to just move down a little more. Okay, these are very, very rare. Okay, a lot of people ask me what these are. I have about 30 of them now. Very, very rare. See, these are the life preserver belts. See, that go on you. See, like that. And what you do is you turn these little ends here, and they puncture a 6-inch long CO2 cartridge, and that would fill up this whole belt here. And my history book says a belt like this would actually hold, when it's full, about 350 pounds in the water. And they wore these when they came off the landing craft. Okay, over here, this is the Navy searchlight with the original generator that they would have signaled the ships with to bring more landing craft to the beach. And over here, we have a small medic display. See, we got the stretcher, we got all the medic equipment, the operating tools, the band-aids, the medicine, all the stuff they would have used back then. Here, check this out. This is morphine still in the box. Here, this is what morphine looks like. You see that in all the Army movies. There's actually a needle in here, and let's say the soldier just got shot in the arm. The medic would come over, stick this right into your skin, he'd squeeze that, all the fluid would go into your arm and numb the whole area in about 2.5 minutes. Morphine, very hard to find. Okay, guys, well anyway, you don't get any more realistic than this. Okay, on June 6, 1944, over 150,000 Americans and Allied troops stormed the Normandy beaches in France. Unfortunately, Omaha Beach and Utah Beach, the first 24 hours on the American beaches, over 4,400 American young kids, soldiers, got killed and gave their lives. They had no idea how bad it was going to be, what they were in for. But they did it, and they really saved the world. If they didn't do it, and we didn't win, this would have been a whole different world. We probably all won't even be here today. This is the American GI coffin that the men were sent back in. Most of the men were buried right around Omaha and Utah Beach, all around France. Okay, so the soldier was put in the body bag, sealed in a steel coffin. Here, look at this. I have brand new body bags, never open. The soldier was sealed in a steel coffin. The coffin was put in these wooden crates. This is a wooden coffin shipping crate, stacked up on the ships and brought back to America. But unfortunately, most of them were just buried right out there. Okay, guys, I want to thank you for watching. This is very, very interesting stuff. I'm always learning more and getting more stuff from the collectors I deal with overseas. Okay, let's take a few seconds out and read the sign. And thank you very much for watching.